Ritu, how are you? And welcome to Ahimsa Conversations. So,
Delighted.
thank you, thank you. What is your earliest recollection of either the concept or the reality of nonviolence?
I grew up at a time when this country was won by nonviolence. It was not that we were Gandhians in our family, but we looked at the manner in which we won our freedom as the North Star. My father was with the Life Insurance Corporation, and he is still, his ethics is still it's still something that I look to attain. I haven't reached that level of ethics that he had. And one of his primary ethics was, don't hurt anybody, not physically, but emotionally. He took great pleasure in making people feel comfortable and happy. And in a sense, my grandmother, his mother, we had long conversations. In those days, young people had conversations with the elderly, And over a period of time, there were conversations that she would read the Gita every day, and she would read me passages from the Gita every day. This was when I was about 10, 11, 12, 13, etc. And we differed, I said, how can this be? How can that be? And to cut a long story short, the fact that I grew up in a family that had innate ethics built in. My grandmother was trying to convince me about God and religion and this and that. And I said, my only religion, even at the age of 12 and 13, my only religion is the leaf that falls, the water that runs, etc. And she says, "बिट्टू बेटा, तुझे पता ही नहीं, तूने पिछले जन्म में गीता लिखी थी." So let me put it like this, that my earliest memory of what you might call ahimsa was what my grandmother taught me. Don't hurt anybody, what my father lived his life doing, make people feel happy, and in other people's happiness, feel happiness.
So from there, Bittu, I sense that there was a direct link between this upbringing and your deep commitment to the natural world and to conservation and to environmentalism. So can you describe that link?
Actually, there was the link was the chain was broken in between, because I was 12, 13, 14. It was one thing, you ask a child he wants to grow up to be a vet or something. I didn't ever want to be a vet, but I was always fascinated by things natural. But then as time went by, I went to so many schools in such a short period of time. I was in Hyderabad, I was in Chandigarh, I was in Ambala, I was in Jamshedpur, and growing up in places like these, you met with people who had completely different, completely divergent values. And I was born in Simla and I went back to Simla to study. And in our school, Bishop Cotton School, Simla, visiting lecturers and people giving talks would arrive. And one of them came when I was all of 15 years old and said, "You know what, if you want to be a he-man," telling the whole school, "maybe you should be able to go to the Andaman Islands where they have released spotted deer, and you should shoot them because they are killing the forest, and you should sell that meat in Calcutta, in Newmarket, that was called Hog Market then, and that's a wonderful way for you to earn a living." So for 6 months, he had me hypnotized. I thought I was going to be a hunter somewhere between Tarzan and Jim Corbett. And then I had a house master, a wonderful man called Freddie Brown, who sat me down and explained to me the rainbow of options in life. It took 6 months for that thought to go out of my head. But I can tell you that my line from my grandmother to now was broken several times. Several times. When I came back to Calcutta after Simla, after I finished graduation and I joined college in Calcutta, I fell in love with this wonderful lady called Madhu, and her father sort of said, "Ki ye support kaise karega?" So I said, "Support karunga," So I became a salesman. I had a motorbike at the age of 17, and I used to sell 220-liter plastic buckets to the chemical industry. So just imagine, at one time I was supposed to be a hunter, at another time, of course, as a kid, I thought I'll grow up and have a bookshop so I can read comics and books all day long, but that dream died. But look, to cut the story short, something happened to me. I don't know precisely what. It was never one thing. It was a whole series of things. And I fell in love with the Sundarbans very early in my life. I would go to a place called Kakdweep on my motorcycle and keep looking for the tiger. And the fishermen there would say, Mama to udar hai. Udar hai means towards Bangladesh. Kakdweep was way to the west, you know. And I mean, it's John Lennon's fault, actually. He said, life is what happens to you while you make other plans. So while trying to earn a living and then becoming an advertising guy, I was a communicator. I was writing copy, I was handling clients, I was doing this, that, and the other. I stumbled, literally stumbled upon a man called Fateh Singh Rathore in Ranthambore. And between him and Kailash Sankla, so many things happened where he said that, look, do you realize it wasn't just the Maharajas and the British who were killing the tiger? We are killing the tiger. We're cutting its forests. We're doing this. We're doing that. And something clicked and then my life changed. So itni lambi answer maine de di choti si question pe. Sorry.
No, it's wonderful. So Bittu, maybe this is where we jump into the complexity of the violence and non-violence dynamic in nature. And I know from our past conversations that you get very upset when people speak about Jungle Raj in a pejorative sense. So can you now describe how over the years, you know, in an overview, because you've been now in this field for what, more than 40 years, how do you see the dynamic between violence and non-violence in nature?
You know, I'll put it to you like this. In nature, there is no violence as violence we know. Human beings are the only ones who know how to create violence for the sake of creating violence, you know. I think Jungle Raj, I would love to have Jungle Raj back again in the world, not just in India, because in the jungle, irrespective of anything, there are certain rules and laws which are not enforced in terms of incarceration and punishment and judgment. They're life and death. You obey or you die. This, I mean, it was said by Darwin and it was said by Gandhi and it was said by everybody that, look, flow with the tide of nature and everything would be all right. I think that at this moment in time, the complexities are truly, truly almost, you can't untangle them, you know, because I believe that we human beings, we imagine we are the gods we invented now. You know, for me, truly, that argument with my grandmother still takes place. That tiger you see behind me is not a tiger. He's just a metaphor for all of Kudrat. And I feel that the violence of shooting a tiger is a lesser violence than the violence of taking away an entire forest. So when you say forest, it's not just, oh, how beautiful the tiger is, how lovely. The fact is that our people knew you cannot go right now to any place, anywhere in India, where there is a water stream or a river as wide as, let's say, 30, 35 feet without finding at its source a temple. Now, that temple is not like Ankleshwar. The temple is sometimes just an assembly of rocks, some evidence of something that was left over there in prayer. We worshipped nature. We worshipped nature in all its avatars, you know. We worship the sun rising, we worship the moon, we worship the clouds, we worship the wind, Pavan, we worship the waters, every river, Narmada, Maya, Ganga, Ma, you know, we worshipped everything. I don't know what happened, but somewhere down the line, and it wasn't just at independence and before independence, it was even before that, the erosion had started, where instead of a source of life, all the things that we see around us became resources for life, tradable resources. I think that that attitude, it represents violence in its worst form. I'm not saying that we should sit down over there like plants turn green and by photosynthesis we survive. We are animals. The law of the jungle is eat or be eaten. But the law of the jungle is not kill everything that you don't eat, you know. So let's put it like this. It's complex. The worst thing that has happened actually is that those people, when the British left India in 1947, they left behind the tools of colonization. Those tools of colonization were tools of violence. Everybody now speaks so glowingly about the railway tracks, but all those railway tracks led from one forest to one port. Everybody talks about the lovely roads that were built. The roads were made so that territories could be conquered, you know. And I'm not saying we don't want roads and we don't want this. I'm just saying that sometimes I feel that the one strategy that the British used so effectively to rule India for so long, to divide and rule, we not only use the jackboots of colonization that were left behind, we inflicted upon ourselves the injury of the strategy of divide and rule. And if I've done one thing in the last 30 years of my life, it's to try and build a bridge between those people who are dependent upon the forest and those people like myself who have respect for them, but who also know ki na rahe baas, na baje baansuri, that if the forest is not there, if the biosphere goes, then there is no, forget about human rights. There is no economy, there is no health, there is no happiness, there is no sustenance, there is nothing. So I would have loved to see somehow or the other, the likes of Baba Amte, the likes of Sundarlal Bahuguna, the likes of Shivram Karant. I would have loved to see them having passed on attitudes that they had, not only for what they felt, but for the person who opposed them. They never had hatred for anybody. What has happened to us right now? I feel that that is violence, you know, that if somebody who disagrees with me becomes the enemy, how can he be the enemy? How can he be the enemy if you disagree with me about something? I may never convince you in all my life, but don't thopo on me your conception of what I must be because I don't believe in this or that or that. And that kind of tolerance is missing in India today. It's missing in the world today. And all those chest thumpers who go around saying my way or the highway, I feel actually a little sorry for them because life is just passing by like sand slipping through their windows, through their fingers. And the hatred that they feel is stealing the joy of life from them.
Too many of the other people who have spoken in this series have talked about how they find the opposite of this still very much in the fabric of society in India. How much the striving for nonviolence as an everyday way of life, whether it is in the tribal or it is in the village, land owning and cultivating peasantry and many other. So can you share some of the experiences in, because you know, you've been so close to the ground on all these issues. What are some of the ways in which you have seen the assertion for nonviolence in this sense, where there is no enemy, but there is justice and right to be fought for, or there are loves to be, loves of nature and love of other sentient being, that are lived out in all their color and complexity?
I keep harking back to the people that I spoke about, you know, Sugatha Kumari, for instance, you know, she used poetry to propagate nonviolence. It might not have been nonviolence in the way that we are talking about it right now, but it was nonviolence. She was a cement. All these people were cement, and there are many more people like that, many, many more people like that living today. But somehow or the other, the polarization that takes place.
Sorry, Vittu, can you just explain that term a little more? You said she was a?
She was the cement.
Ah, cement. Okay, binding, a binder. Okay, okay.
She was a binder. She was a cement that that bound people, she could speak about this, but the values were the same as this. And then you suddenly never became the other, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, in my entire life, I could never hope to be even near to somebody like that in terms of their mental evolution, because was so pure.
Since many people watching may not know her, Bittu, can you just give a one or two sentences on who she was?
Let me put it like this. I came to know her because she was viscerally opposed to the Silent Valley Dam. You know, she was viscerally opposed to the Silent Valley Dam. And the fact is that whenever I spoke to, let's say, Shivram Karanth, he would refer to her. I spoke to Medha Patkar, she would refer to her. I would speak to, you name it, you know, Mrinal Gore would speak about her. And it was with the Narmada Bachao Andolan, she was a North Star. She was one of those people who had the courage to speak softly about things that were hard without hurting people, with the venom that we see now as the norm. So I think that it's not too late. I think that those lessons have not died. They're just like pilot flames. It takes one person from here. I miss Meetu Kothari from the bottom of my heart today, because he let us down by dying early, you know. He was the person who could have made the groups come together that could have thwarted those who are perpetuating ultimate violence on the planet, on India, on us, by turning to dust that which is beautiful and that which is sustaining us, you know. So I don't know, we can go in so many different directions, but Sugatha Kumari, Sundarlal Bahuguna, Baba Amte, I mean, Shivram Karant, I had the pleasure of, for 1.5 days, looking after Shivram Karant during one of the Narmada Bachao Andolan gatherings that had taken place. He was so elderly and he still came. And my job was to make sure he doesn't stumble and fall. And when he would speak to me, it was like prayers were being read out, you know. And I'm being a little over romantic right now about the old days, but then that's Buddha Party ka privilege, you know.
So since you mentioned Narmada Bachao Andolan, many people have said that, I mean, the mainstream view is that, oh, what did the movement achieve? The dams were still built. There is also one political view of thought which says that Narmada Bachao Andolan is proof that there are very severe limits to nonviolence. And a claim is sometimes made that had the, you know, Andolan been violent, it may have achieved more. So I'd like you to respond to all this. And what is your assessment of, you know, the significance of the Narmada Bachao Andolan despite these provocations remaining nonviolent?
I would put it like this, that the Narmada Bachao Andolan woke the world up. It chose nonviolence because from its visceral origins, it realized that violence begets violence. I could subdue you now by getting a crowbar and coming into your house, but that's not going to endear you to me. And life is not one moment of anger. Life is a whole lifetime of living in one form or the other. You know, what are we? We are just bumped up monkeys, you know. And we live essentially in troops. We live as a community. We live as a family. We live as a village. And in every village, in every house, in every family, you will find people who khatpat to hoti hai the. Lekin if that khatpat turns into violence, which is either psychological, emotional, or physical, then you are broken. You've broken rules. Those rules essentially are that if you surround yourself with unhappiness, you cannot, as an island, live a happy life within. I find no pleasure in giving somebody else unhappiness, for the lack of any word, you know, by hurting somebody. I must have hurt so many people, but it was never intentional. And if I found out that I did, I try to make good what I might have done. I'm ready to admit that I made the mistakes. I would like to speak about one act of violence that took place around 1972-73, just before I had gotten into this whole issue, when Project Tiger was declared, at that point, like a steamroller, people were moved out of their homes to keep the tiger alive. The tiger had been virtually wiped out. And a very cold decision was taken. And the people who paid the ultimate price, the only people who paid the real price were the people living in that forest and around that forest. If I had a time machine, I would go back and make reparations for that. But the fact is that had that not happened, had Project Tiger not come in and told Indira Gandhi and told the government of India that what the British did was to take away the forest to build its armadas earlier and then to trade. If we start doing the same thing, there will be nothing left. Dahi jamane ke liye jamun chahiye, wo jamun ki lassi agar koi banana chahe, to phir kuch bhi nahi rahega. So as far as the biosphere is concerned, the biosphere makes no judgments that Bittu, you're a good guy, such and such poacher, you're a bad guy. The biosphere just gives you warnings and then it gives you consequences. And the floods and droughts that we see today, these are a direct result, and the pandemic is a direct result of our ignorance, arrogance, avarice, apathy, you know, and our inability to come together. If I differ with somebody in the human rights groups, I don't go out and curse him. I am trying to build a bridge. When I say I am talking about a collective lot of us, both sides of the fence. And the same goes for those people who are doing mining and building dams and things like this. I don't hate any one of those people. I hate what they do. But that doesn't mean I will go out in public and insult the person. I might insult him by writing and exposing, but certainly not by, abusing. It doesn't help. I don't know. We're drifting a bit. So bring us back.
No. I think we are very much on track. But do you mention the pandemic? And many people have written about this and spoken about it, that the pandemic is in a sense a blowback for the violence that we have been doing against nature. Can you explain that in a way that, you know, because a lot of people who are not deeply engaged in the environmental movement find it sometimes a little complicated to know what is the issue here. How is the pandemic the price we are paying for our own violence?
Actually, it's not difficult to understand. And if I may I pretend that you are 12 years old right now?
Please do. I am in any case.
Here is what it is. That the forest itself is like a self-repairing machine. Jaise aapka haath mein cut ho jayega, automatically theek hi ho jayega. Zara malam laga do to theek hai, na bhi laga do to theek hi ho jayega wo. Now, as far as the pandemic is concerned, there are some things that we must know, which we know from science today. The pandemic was a direct result of the wildlife, the global illegal wildlife trade. It was also the direct result of the extirpation of ecosystems to usher in what human beings call development. How does this happen? A child had asked me once and I said, look, it's like this. You have heard the expression, love me, love my dog. Well, there's a bat. There is a certain virus in the bat. Without that virus, the bat probably can't live. And without the bat, that virus can't live. तो वो अपने बहुत अच्छी पार्टनरशिप में संतुलन में बैठे रहे. अभी मैं उस बैट के घर में जाता हूँ. I go there, I eat the bat, I take the bat, I move him out, or I cut the tree on which 1,000 bats are nesting and resting, and then they have to go out. And I have taken species like the bat and separated the virus from the bat. As it happens, it's called spillover. The virus spilled over from a bat and it went into another animal, which was one of the largest traded mammals in the world, called the pangolin. At very high prices, these pangolins are masalaed, cut up, dried, sent out, sent off to Wuhan, China, here, there, and everywhere else. And from there, because we would not just, the bats maybe have been eaten in China, but in right now in India, wet markets exist in which pangolins are being traded, not just eaten. So when you eat that pangolin, the virus has gone from the bat to the pangolin, from the pangolin to you, to me. And in the process, there are not as many pangolins as there are human beings. So the virus has, uski to eid ho gayi. Wo to mana raha hai, khushi se. What a lovely piece of meat I am. So the virus has come to human beings and is spreading like wildfire, and our immune systems have no defense against it because never seen that virus before. And in a sense, what a 12-year-old understands is everything in its place and a place for everything. So while the ecosystems, whether they are wetlands, whether they are grasslands, whether they are deserts, whether they are forests, whether they are tropical forests, whether they are montane forests, whether they are arid forests, all these creatures and their viruses have lived together. And in our own body, we have got viruses. Without those viruses, we would be nothing, you know. So the virus is not our enemy. The enemy is our lack of understanding of what causes life. We never gave birth to life. We never created one forest. Not a single Adivasi community has practices in which they go about planting trees. They worship trees. But the Mahua tree, which every urban activist understands, is such a tree worthy of worship. Sometimes some of the activists I find do not understand that the Adivasi worships the moth and the bat that pollinates the tree as well. That is not an elitist middle class desire to save wildlife. It is a desire to save life itself. These were the gardeners of Eden. Ye hamare van ke mali hain. Agar hum apne van ke maliyon ke upar matlab ki hamla karna shuru kar dein ya let somebody do it, to hamare van jiyega kahan? We don't know how to plant. It's the bee, it's the bat, it's the ant, it's the moth, it's the this, it's the that, it's a nematode, it's an earthworm. And the soil, when people like me, because of the tiger, because you use the tiger as a metaphor, are accused of loving animals more than people, all my response is, but we are animals. We are animals. And by protecting a large area, you have protected the soil bacteria. All those creatures. And anyway, as there's a connection between the pandemic, let's put it like this, there's a connection between pandemic and climate change and economics and human rights. And I would urge today through this conversation that kal ki baat bhool jao. We are in a time of crisis right now. There are people going along obliterating ecosystems upon which our lives are dependent. We don't have the technology to look after those ecosystems. We have to only look after them by allowing the creatures that evolved with those ecosystems to survive. Then they will bring back the ecosystems, and that will not just save us from a pandemic, it will probably be the first steps forward towards getting some balance back in the climate wobble that has come this miserable climate crises.
And yet at the same time, Mitu, you have spoken just before we started, you were saying that despite this, blaring alarm bell, which is ringing in the form of the pandemic, we are seeing just now a further deterioration in the protections that could even today save the ecosystems. You've spoken about that. And take the Himalayas, for example. We've now had, in the last 10 years, I can remember at least two catastrophic floods. I'm not talking about the smaller ones that may be happening more often. And yet there is no pullback from the project to to build an indefinite number of dams on the Himalayan rivers. So how do you deal with this reality? In a situation where the alarm bells continue to be ignored by the power structure, or the efforts that are made seem infinitesimal? Or am I wrong in understanding your assessment? Because I'm, in a sense, I'm putting your assessment in the form of a question to ask you to tell me then what is now the next level. You know, because the next thing I want you to talk about is the Extinction Rebellion. But first, your perspective, and then I want to know how you see the Extinction Rebellion.
I'll tell you. You know, what has happened is, I had mentioned earlier that somehow or the other, this human brain has invented itself as the Lord and Master of all. And we have deluded ourselves into believing that we created the world. We may worship everything over there, but aaj ke din mein, we believe ki agar koi humne kharab bhi kiya, to theek bhi kar denge. Pura matlab ki, Ken Betwa project hum banayenge, wo jungle doob jayega, lekin hum tropical pine yahan dalenge, eucalyptus wahan dalenge, ya chalo koi baat nahi, badh ke ped dal denge, aur sab theek ho jayega, theek nahi hoga. You asked about the Himalaya. Here is the lunacy that I see in play right now. A dam is only as good as the water that flows from a river which is blocked by a wall. It catches the rain, which is why it's called a catchment area. And that catchment area, it rains for 4 months, but the water should keep flowing for 12 months so that you can use that water in the times when it doesn't rain. Now, at one level, think about what we are doing in the Himalaya. The glaciers have melted or are melting. We are taking river flow data based on the 80s and 90s, and we are projecting them for cost-benefit ratios. I'm now talking economics. I'm not talking human rights. I'm not talking wildlife. I'm not talking anything. I'm talking economics. People who have got short-term economic motives are destroying long-term economic objectives. Those dams are stranded assets before they are completed. What is going against those dams, first of all, is the fact that the glaciers are not producing as much water, and they are not giving you the water when you need it. They're giving you the water when you don't need it often. The second thing is, in order to build these dams, you're talking about 300, 200 large dams. You're talking about 1,000 smaller dams. You're talking about mines and quarries. You're talking about roads. You have destabilized the Himalaya to the point where a drizzle is enough to cause a landslide. What we saw happening in the recent past, the disasters that we have seen, those are just angdai. Aage to ladai hai Himalaya ke upar jo humne jung declare kar diya hai. Himalaya to aise karega na, to beh jayegi sab kuch. Ambition will be beh jao, and so will our homes, so will our roads, so will our money, so will everything. So on the Himalayan front, I would say that, you know, the old thing about Shiv's hair being the one that controls the Ganga, take that to be symbolic of what the forests are. So when we ask for the forests of the Himalayan slopes to be protected, what we are asking is that kudrat ke saath chalo, kudrat ke khilaf mat jang karo. This is one, but then there are many, many, many other examples all the way through, to talk again on the basis of science, which is actually teaching us not to takrofy with nature, that violence against nature is actually unscientific to the point of stupidity. When you talk of people who are now looking forward to having the equivalent of wall-to-wall solar panels, and I celebrate the fact that we are talking of alternate energy, wall-to-wall solar panels, every 10 square meters put up a windmill, all this will not pull down 1 ounce of carbon from the atmosphere, which we've already put up. How are we going to do that? So if you ask me today, between at one level ahimsa, at another level worship, what we should do is to worship the system. You take a seed, you put it down somewhere inside a forest, which is what every bird, every insect, every butterfly, every bee is doing. Every time that tree grows up and becomes a 10-ton tree, 50% of its dry weight is atmospheric carbon. Not a blade of grass, not a house plant, not a tree, not a mahua tree, not a peepal tree. Nothing can grow without taking atmospheric carbon and turning. This is called photosynthesis. My 12-year-olds will understand that. So the children ask me, ki bittu uncle, jab ye inko pata hai, to phir ye kyon kar rahe hain? To jawab to hai nahi mera. But solution to hai. Aaj ke din mein, if we have got a pandemic which has caused more people to migrate than migrated at the time of independence, then just imagine one thing. Those people, many will come back, then they'll go, many will come back, but many will stay there. We need to give them dignified employment where they are, dignified livelihoods where they are. And I cannot think of a more legitimate national developmental purpose which is rooted in ahimsa than to say that, okay, we've already built dams. First of all, out of the 1,000+ dams, I would say 200 need to be decommissioned right away. The other thing is that the connection between a dam and its catchment forest is the connection between your teeth and your gums. No point having beautiful orthodontia if your gum disease is going to cause your teeth to fall out. So when you build a dam and you destroy the catchment, mud slides into the reservoir. So each time a politician or an engineer or a businessman celebrates, oh, the dams are overflowing, the dams are overflowing. Mujhe kabhi lagta hai ki mere bhai kabhi niche dive karke dekho, the ground of the dam is rising also. All the silt from there is coming down, and what you thought was a dam this deep is actually only this deep. So if we allow nature and nature's solutions to come back into play, then contour buns, contour trenches, nulla plugs, a few protective things, unnecessary fires don't take place. I could imagine that between 20 to 30 million people could be put back to work within 15 kilometers of where they live in rural India, if the catchment areas of downstream dams, I'm saying, but let's say the rivers, I'd rather refer to them as rivers rather than dams. If those could be restored using nature-based solutions, then I think India has a chance of surviving. If we don't, we have too many people in too small a place. We eat too much, we consume too much, we waste too much. We have too much disrespect for each other. We are too different. When resources are diminished, at that point, violence emerges. Because all the wars that you have, they have been fought over one resource or the other. A resource is not gold and diamonds and jewels and coal. A resource is sometimes just water. A resource is sometimes just land that I can grow food on. So through all this gachar pachar rigmarole, the solution for the 12-year-old is this. Don't make the mistakes that my generation made. We were gifted freedom. We never fought for it, my generation. For you all, we are gifting you a world in which people like me have mourned. There has been a funeral in my life, every day of my life, since I became cognizant of what is happening. Something I loved has died. Somebody I loved was hurt. Some values I had were broken. But the next generation which is coming up, which is why we run Kids for Tigers, you know, and we run it in villages more than we run it in cities. We are telling them ki jo kudrat se takrayega wo mitti mein mil jayega, chalo wo to hai, lekin jo kudrat ke saath saath chale wo kudrat uska chhaya banke unko protect bhi karegi, you know. So I feel that the children of today will be celebrating a birthday every day. Jahan main ro raha tha wahan wo, we teach children a simple thing. Again, now let's pretend you're 9 years old. When we see a new leaf somewhere, and we've taken the children of the village, we work in 45 villages around Ranthambore. I haven't gone inside Ranthambore for the last 8 years or 10 years. But in the villages outside, we literally sing to them, happy birthday, new leaf, happy birthday, new leaf, because a new leaf has come up. And this is the way we teach them ki sab kuch theek ho sakta hai. Grasses will come back, bushes will come back, deer will come back, monkeys will come back, tigers will come back. So this is what will happen. And jungle, nadi ki maa hai, jungle wapas aaye, pani bhi aayegi, nadi bhi behegi. And all the grasslands that we see, those grasslands are the forests of Kutch. Those grasslands are the forests of things. We cannot, under any circumstances, continue to, believe ki we can perpetuate violence on people. And on people, for me, people is not just you and me. People is life on earth. We cannot continue to perpetrate violence on them and expect that things will be perfectly all right. I think we've run over time in any case.
No, one last thing. Bittu, I know that you must be watching the Extinction Rebellion very closely. What advice would you give to young people today who are able, I think young people have a pretty sharp assessment of how grim their future threatens to be. And some are drawn towards the approach that you are suggesting, that is towards address the crisis by deepening nonviolence. But they find it very daunting, many of them. So what, from your vast experience, is some of the advice you would give for how they can walk down this path? And above all, what are some of the internal strengths that they could cultivate and how?
You know, dhiraj rakho, patience honi chahiye. Ye Buddha party jo hai, according to me, do hi political parties hain is duniya mein, Buddha party aur Bachcha party. Aaj ke din mein agar Gandhi ji jeete the, agar he was alive today, he would not have said, first, before you do anything, will it benefit the poorest of the poor? He would say, before you do anything, rich or poor, north or south, black or white, will it benefit the child who's going to grow up tomorrow? So what I would tell the children of today is, and what I do tell them, is that everything will be all right. It'll be a rough time. My generation is being phased out. We are in the departure lounge. Some of us are trying to keep the arrival lounge for you as functional as possible. Trust in nature. That automatically is trust in nonviolence. Believe that everything will work out all right, because it will work out all right. Do not think that another creature has a lesser right to live than you. And be hopeful and be happy every day of your life. Sanctuary, the magazine that I run, we are launching, you talked of the Extinction Rebellion. The Extinction Rebellion is a young person's message to my generation, to say that these creatures that you are causing to go extinct are the lifeblood of our planet, of our life. Biodiversity is nothing but the immune system of the planet. If you damage the immune system, then you will fall sick. And if you fall sick, you will not repair well. So the Extinction Rebellion is, the look at the word, Extinction Rebellion. Now, I would actually turn it on its head, and together with, at least I can think of about nearly 1,000 people around the world that we are in touch with, we would prefer to call it the Survival Rebellion. That now, let's not have necessarily, you need that. You'd like the diversity of a forest, you need diversity of nomenclature, diversity of thoughts. The Survival Rebellion is basically what is going to plant seeds in young minds that if you keep species alive, if you keep ecosystems alive, if you bring nature back, if like the pandemic has allowed blue skies and Yamuna to flow free, if we bring that back, resources will come to you in a way. What is it that I want for my children? I want clean air. I want good health. I want happiness. I want safe food. I don't have anything more that I want for them. And that will only come through something called, what I believe, the Survival Rebellion, where the young people get together and tell the elders, here is for you an adult literacy program. Each one, teach one. Every child, teach an adult what the real priorities in life are. Sitting above the tiger's head somewhere, Gandhiji is saying the same thing. For those who have ears, let them listen. Join hands, you'll be stronger. Separate, you are giving everybody who wants to destroy life on earth a gift.
Thank you so much, Bittu. Thank you for making the time, and thank you for doing what you do.